Elings Park is an amazing resource for the community. It's this big park between Santa Barbara and Goleta, and so many people use it. They have over 200,000 visitors a year.
Elings Park is a private nonprofit park, which is very unusual in the world of parks. We're 230 acres, which is more than twice the size of the Disneyland park. We're open 365 days a year, and I can tell you access to green space has never been more in demand.
It's a place where hikers, mountain bikers, dog walkers, bird watchers, athletes, nature enthusiasts all come together and enjoy Santa Barbara's beautiful climate and environment.
When you hike to the top of the hill, you can see the ocean, you can see the town, and I think it's really a convening place for a lot of people in Santa Barbara.
Elings Park is what was and what can be. It's a beautiful grassland, oak woodland, coastal scrub. Elings also is a place that's been disturbed in some locations, and it needs a helping hand.
It's hard when you're an ecologist not to see all the weeds in a landscape. And there's a lot of weeds at Elings Park, especially up on the mesa where it's been disturbed for so long. So that's what I've seen, is just a landscape in need of some help.
The garden has launched our Landscape Transformations Initiative, and this is a big deal for us. We're looking around the county for ways that we can help inspire our community to use native plants. That starts with both understanding where they already occur, ensuring that if they're at risk, that they continue to exist where they are. But really what we want to do is take those areas that have been degraded over the last several hundred years and bring them back to health. It's not enough to just rely on what we have left. We need to actually restore our planet.
At Elings Park, we're really doing a habitat restoration project that's also a science experiment. What we hope to do with this project is to demonstrate what the science has shown, and that is that when you restore an area from a monoculture of weeds to a diversity of native plants, that life colonizes.
A big impetus for this was to test some of our hypotheses about helping plants migrate under climate change, but it's also a great space to do this kind of work because we really wanted to get the public involved. It's a really popular community hub. It gets a lot of foot traffic, and it also has emotional value to a lot of people in the community.
Elings is perfect because it's really suffered from the last 100 years, where it's both been a dump in some areas that's been capped. It was an old ag field in some areas. And so the opportunity is to show how you can take an area that's been degraded and really improve the health and vitality of that space.
The park has changed dramatically in the last 5 or 6 years.
We've put over 600 trees in the ground, 4,000 coastal shrubs, and most exciting of all is a test acre that we're doing with the Botanic Garden. I'm very curious to see what grows, what's successful up there.
So Elings was dry farmed for a long time, and that kind of tilling and disturbance, when you take that away, what likes that environment? Weeds. They're really well adapted to come into a disturbed area. They reproduce really quickly, they spread really easily, and all kinds of things that make weeds super plants. Elings has some of the world's worst invasives, so it has things like fennel, mustard, pampas grass. If you look across the mesa, that's what you see. There's very rarely a native there on the mesa, and it's just a handful of weeds.
A lot of the times we're going into areas that are covered with invasive plants. These are non-native plants that came from outside the area. Oftentimes they spread and really outcompete other native plants. They don't have the same value that the native plants have because they've left their insects and the other animals that rely on them in other continents. They're not doing the job that our native plants can do.
If you were to introduce plants from another region, they might add diversity technically, but they might not provide the habitat that native plants do, especially when you consider invasive species that really take over and completely reduce biodiversity.
We talk sometimes about the services that ecosystems provide. Biodiversity is what helps us have clean water and clean air. Biodiversity provides the pollination services that are going to create the next generation of plants, the next generation of life, the foods that we eat. But there's also an intrinsic or maybe a personal or spiritual value to biodiversity, and that is the beauty that it provides, the attraction, the fact that we're surrounded by all of these bird sounds right now, the fact that we're surrounded by the buzz of various different species of bees, and we see the colors of butterflies, and that's something that humans are kind of hardwired to appreciate and to look out for.
When we think about biodiversity, it's sort of a catalog of everything in nature, everything on the planet that's alive. But when we think of the web of life, we're interested in how each of those pieces is connected to one another. And you can think of that as maybe a food chain that you learned about in school, but really, all these connections are very complex, and there are a lot of them. So we think of it as a web because really everything has a lot of connections coming off of it, and we don't want to miss any of those pieces.
We're right here sitting in Santa Barbara Botanic Garden in the manzanita section. Manzanitas are the cousins of blueberries, and they have a very specialized flower. And that flower is like a little urn shape. It's a beautiful little delicate thing, but it has a trick. It can't be pollinated by just anything. In fact, it has to be vibrated at a certain frequency before it releases its pollen. And there are only certain bees that are able to vibrate that plant at that certain frequency. And so when we talk about the web of life, we talk about this interconnection, these relationships between organisms. Without those bees buzzing those flowers, we don't have more manzanitas. We also don't have blueberries. We also don't have tomatoes. So the web of life ensures that all of the different strategies for survival and all of the needs of these organisms are met. It all works together.
A diverse ecosystem is more resilient. That means there's just more things doing the different jobs. And so habitat restoration just aims to restore that diversity.
Our restoration projects are aimed at both understanding how best to remove those plants and then also how to establish the native plants that we know will do a better job of supporting wildlife. At Elings Park, we had a range of invasive species that we had to deal with. They've been well established over the last 100 years. And so our goal was to first understand the best way to remove those invasive plants. We did two methodologies. We did solarization, which is covering the area with black plastic and sort of heating up the soil, hopefully to kill some of those underground weeds. And then we also used a sheet mulching methodology where we lay down cardboard and then put down 8 to 10 inches of mulch on top of that.
We're comparing two different kinds of controlling weeds. We're also trying out a variety of different species that we've brought from farther south. And then we're monitoring them to look at their survivorship, their growth, and then also how they support the bugs.
What we're trying to ask at Elings Park is, given the land use history, given all of the human impacts, given the uncertainty of a changing climate, how do we restore ecosystems in coastal California? So we're starting with a 1-acre site, and we're starting by planting lots of native plants that are typically found in the Santa Barbara region, but we're also starting to sprinkle in plants that grow naturally a little bit further south. We know that some of our ecosystems are going to change. So can we get ahead of that and use what we call a climate forward approach to predict what might happen and see how these plants still support the web of life in an uncertain climate?
And what's great about this project, it is a project that is based in sound science. It's very forward looking in that it's not just trying to restore back to what it was and pre-European contact, it's looking at all the global impacts of climate change and how the wildlife that are here, how the ecosystem processes that are occurring in this place are still gonna occur, but looking at a different set of species.
Restoration is so much more than just putting plants in the ground. We have to take rigorous scientific data and figure out how we did it, what happened, and whether that was the outcome we wanted, and if not, how to change it. But one nice thing about using Elings Park as a sort of testing ground is that it's also in the middle of an urban area. So when we move plants, we don't have to worry as much about escape into wildlands because they're sort of boxed off by the city of Santa Barbara. It's a great place for us to test these ecological and restoration-based hypotheses and then take the lessons that we learned and communicate them to land managers and other municipalities to help them do what we're doing here. Here's what worked, here's what didn't. Here's our recipe for success.
What I appreciate about the garden's efforts to restore portions of Elings Park is that's a nice coming together of science, but it also has the community involvement. For conservation to be effective, you have to have community involvement.
The transformation project, I think, for me, is kind of like the keystone or the capstone of all of the work that we've been doing here over the last 5 years to revitalize Elings Park and bring it back to a more natural state.
It benefits us all because we are all in this together. We were all designed to work together. And if we can take this park and make it a model of biodiversity, I can't think of a better use of this space for the people of Santa Barbara.
We wanted an opportunity to do this restoration trial, beautify a place that's important to Santa Barbara and its community, and then also help people get engaged and understand that they really can be empowered to help do restoration. You don't have to be a scientist. You just have to be willing to get your hands a little bit dirty.
The people that live around this park, the people that live in this region, in this city, they can have direct impacts by what they choose to plant in their front and backyard. And if you choose something that's invasive, you choose something that isn't drought tolerant, that is putting more stress, not only on the open spaces, but the rest of the surrounding community.
We're hoping that coming out of Elings, that we leave with an incredible model that has engaged the community, both in understanding what's going on, but also having them take the lessons they've learned there to their own home landscape, so that their landscapes now become part of the support for the rest of biodiversity. We want to see everyone have at least 30% native plants in their front yards or backyards, but of course, that's a floor. I'd love to see people have 50, 70, even 100% native plants.
We've protected a lot of land in California, and we should be really proud of that. But what we haven't protected necessarily are our private lands. And so we have this opportunity, particularly in a place like Santa Barbara, that's adjacent to 1 million acres plus of protected land, thinking about our communities as being islands of habitat that connect the large swaths of protected land, the Forest Service property, the state parks property, the regional parks. And if we create these pockets throughout the landscape, that's going to increase the probability that native biodiversity thrives.
You know, in front of me is the ocean and behind me are these mountains. They're no longer connected by native habitat. So every time a landowner between the ocean, the shore, and the mountain summit behind me, every time someone plants natives in their yard, they're providing stepping stones or islands on which lizards, birds can survive and have that connectivity, that flow, because wildlife doesn't stay in one place. It moves around.
You can still have roses, but consider adding some sages. Consider adding an oak if you have the space. Consider adding some of these native plants that support the web of life. And 30% is a number that is significant, but it's also achievable.
The actions of one person alone may not be enough to change the course of biodiversity or changing climate. The actions of all of us are. And that's the only way changes ever happen in the world. And so I'm actually quite hopeful about what we can do. I've seen people starting to embrace native plants. It makes a difference in their own lives, it makes a difference in their backyards, and it makes a difference for all other species.